All right, our colleague and friend Lauren Sivan is here, and Lauren usually reports the news. You've seen her do it here at KTLA. You've seen her do it for other stations. Now she is part of the news. When the New York Times article came out, because you had your own experience, it was not part of the New York Times article. What was your thought?
Finally. Oh, my God. Finally. Finally. People get to see what this guy is like. And I was so, so impressed with Ashley Judd and Rose McGowan, because I could only imagine the guts it took to come forward against a man like Harvey Weinstein, who's a kingmaker here in Hollywood and one of the most powerful men in the country, really. And I felt like I knew for years what this guy was about, and anyone else I had told my own personal story to was like, oh, yeah, that's Harvey. Everyone knew these rumors forever, but no one was able to make anything stick, and no one was able to really go public in a way that would have any effect.
When you heard that phrase, huh, that's Harvey,
yeah.
Did that anger you?
I don't know if I felt angry. I felt like they believed me. I was always believed. No one ever questioned this bizarre story that I had, and it was, you know, odd and crazy. You know, the thing with the rumors around Hollywood, and obviously there were rumors for years, and whether or not people in Hollywood were aware or weren't aware, rumors are not actionable. So what could people have done when you hear a rumor about that? You know, you would have to take legal action. You would have to have a police record. You would have to go through all those things. That wasn't even available to me in my case. When people ask me, why didn't you run to the police and why didn't you file a lawsuit? Like, I was a local news anchor. Like, I could barely pay my car insurance. I didn't have lawyers at my beck and call. Going to the police, you know, it was my word against his. What was he going to be charged with? Exposure? I mean, that wasn't my logical thought of what to do. I wanted it for my own selfish reasons. I just wanted it to go away. I just wanted to continue to be on the news and, you know, work my way up and not have this as this, you know, incident that defined me or be included with any story mentioning it.
We're talking about the incident. A lot of people don't know what you experienced exactly. I mean, to the extent that you want to tell it, tell people exactly what happened to you.
Well, if you've read all of the news out, there were so many allegations that he would show up to business meetings in a bathrobe. He would ask women to shower with him or get in the bath with him. I never had meetings with Harvey Weinstein. I wasn't an actress. I wasn't trying to be an actress. I met him, you know, by chance at a dinner party in New York City one night where he just happened to be sitting next to me. And he was, you know, very lovely. We chatted about news. He chatted about history and politics and at that time, you know, you're kind of desperate to be taken seriously. And I was so flattered that this, you know, Hollywood mogul was so impressed with my knowledge about things and was actually talking to me intellectually. And there was nothing inappropriate that transpired. It wasn't until he asked me if I wanted a tour of the restaurant we were in. He said, you know, I'm one of the owners. I would love to give you a tour. Have you seen downstairs? I said, no, I haven't. And I followed him, and that's when I immediately realized, once we got downstairs, that this was not what I thought it was going to be, that there was no one in this kitchen, it was dark, it was basically any people there, he kind of shooed away, and he kind of cornered me in, I don't know, in between some bathrooms, so that the only way I could get out was past him again. And, you know, there's no TV savvy way to say what transpired. Unfortunately, he tried to kiss me. I politely said no thank you, and I wasn't interested. And that's when he exposed himself and masturbated in front of me. And when he was finished, I asked, are we done? Can I leave? And we both walked out, and I grabbed my friend, my girlfriend, who was on her way looking for me, and we ran out. And I told her the story immediately. I told my family the story. I told, you know, many, many people the story through the years. It was something that happened that was so bizarre and so unexpected. I don't know what the natural reaction is to something.
And then to add insult to injury, what happened the next day?
That's the weirdest part in this story. The next day, I'm at my TV station, I'm at work, and I get a phone call in my office, and I hear, I have Harvey Weinstein on the line for you. And my heart sinks because, what now? Like, what now? And he gets on the phone and just says, hi, I'm just calling because I wanted to tell you I had a lovely evening. And I couldn't wrap my brain around while I was hearing. I was like, you had a lovely evening. I had a great time. I would love to see you again. I'm going on a work trip. I'm going here. I'm going there. But when I get back on this such and such date, I would love to take you out again. I like my mind was just racing. I was like, I don't think, no, thank you. First of all, I thought I made it clear last night. I'm really not interested in anything. And I quickly got off the phone with him. I honestly don't remember the exact words I used, but that was that. And, you know, he never contacted me again. I came to Hollywood some years later, and I would see him at events, at red carpets, you know. And if he did recognize me, he never showed me he did, thankfully. And I tried to avoid having to interview him anytime I could. But, you know, all the years that I've been telling this story, all the people that either knew him or didn't know him or weren't surprised, no one was ever like, why didn't you go to the police? Why didn't you, you know, call someone in the Weinstein company and tell them? Like, that's never been the answer. It's always been, you want to stay away from him.
And do you think that speaks to, a lot of people are talking now about a quote-unquote power divide or something like that?
Sure. I think when you have a power divide like that, like in this situation where you have Harvey Weinstein, who's a Hollywood kingmaker, inviting these, you know, young, some unknown actresses to a business meeting in your hotel room, whether or not it's consensual, it's absolutely not consensual because of that power divide. It can't be. I mean, just because of the position he's in, you don't have a way out. You don't have a way to politely extricate yourself. And that's why so many of these actresses, if they could get out of the situation, they did and just politely tried to never get themselves in the situation again. And yet they still have to pose with him at photos on red carpets. They'd still have to praise him when they won awards. I mean, think about what that must have been like. Thankfully, I never had to have anything to do with him again.
24 hours ago, literally 24 hours ago, Mira Sorvino was sitting in the seat.
That's right.
And when we brought up his name, you could just see and feel and hear this rush of emotion and this pain. The New Yorker article came out 24 hours ago. The New Yorker article dramatically advances what was said in the New York Times. What was your thought upon looking at this article?
If you hear the audio that accompanied this article, and I don't know if you've been playing it on your air, but if you hear that audio, you can hear a woman who's desperate to get away, to get out of this situation, who's making it clear in her second language, right? She, in no uncertain terms, that she's very uncomfortable. I want to leave. I want to go. I do not want to follow you into this bathroom. And you hear him in that tape. He's absolutely relentless. He's absolutely relentless. He's working himself up into a frenzy to get this woman, just 1 minute, just I swear on my children, I swear on this, I swear on that, to get her into a situation that she makes clear she's very uncomfortable in. So you can imagine all the other women that went through this. You can imagine what they were up against. This man who's telling me, hey, if you don't follow me, you're never gonna hear from me again. This is it. This is your chance. Don't blow it. Think about the pressure that puts on someone who's trying to make a career in Hollywood. Like I said, I was very, very lucky. Not an actress. I didn't want to be in Hollywood. I didn't have to ever talk to him again. I didn't need anything or want anything from him. Was I scared, though, that if I did anger him with one phone call, he could probably get me fired. He could probably prevent me from working elsewhere. But what these actresses had to deal with, it's unimaginable.
And then yesterday, quote-unquote name actresses, Gwyneth Paltrow, Angelina Jolie, when they speak out, it's going to sound so weird, does that make you feel better?
I think it illustrates just how powerful this guy was. When you have Gwyneth Paltrow, who comes from a very powerful Hollywood family, you have Rosanna Arquette, who comes from a very powerful Hollywood family, if their families couldn't protect these women, you know, think about the young 20-year-old actress who gets on a bus from Oklahoma and just wants to make her way there. Like, what chance would she have if these actresses didn't have a chance? I mean, what risk he takes in preying on people that are not only well-known in Hollywood, but who I'm sure he's worked with their parents, with, you know, their families. That's what I hope everybody gleans from this, just how powerful and manipulative he was. And when, you know, you blame women for not speaking out and not telling their stories, do not blame these women. You know, blame his enablers. Blame the people that helped keep his secrets for so long.
What do you want to see Harvey Weinstein do, or what is the appropriate punishment, or what's next for him? What do you want to see happen?
Well, I mean, I was happy to see he's not head of a studio anymore. He's not head of his company anymore. But if those allegations in the New Yorker are true, he should be in jail. He should be in jail if he is, in fact, you know, guilty of raping these women. Yeah.
Lauren, thanks very much for coming in this morning.
Thanks, you guys.
We appreciate it.
Thank
you. Thanks so much.
Sure.